Hello and welcome to this little discussion on this week's issue. Perhaps you are stuck in a traffic jam even as you are watching this, or most certainly you are at point A proceeding to point B, or at point B having come from point A through something that involves us all, which is traffic. That's what we've done, and it's normally seen as a very mundane part of our life in every day. Very frustrating. No one ever has a pleasant experience of traffic. And the reason why we are talking about it is, as you all know, we have a brand new law, the Motor Vehicles Act 2019. It updates a 30-year-old law. And we have been granted a slightly frightening scenario of very hefty fines in case of violations and this and that. And we have looked at pretty much all aspects covering the issue. It's very wonderfully laid out. Please do pick up the issue. And on the last page, I might just tell you, as the story ends, there is a little thing on Japanese sake, which, let me warn you, is not part of the story. It's an ad. So the story ends here. Don't read Japanese sake along with fines on drunken driving. And we have certainly have had a long course during which a new law was perhaps badly required. The situation on our roads has changed considerably from 1988, when the previous law was enacted. The road, the kilometers of road, the miles of road that we have out there have probably not changed much. Some incremental changes would have been there, especially in cities. But the number of vehicles has gone up exponentially. So what we are experiencing is a very, very different situation now in the latter part of the second decade of this century than we had, let's say, in the early 90s. Delhi, for instance, used to be blessed with the highest kilometrage of roads. And now, a few years ago, a study had revealed that the traffic moves slower in Delhi than even in Bombay. So that's the number of cars that have actually come out on the road, which obviously means traffic jams where you're stuck right now, and a whole lot of other things. Because of traffic jams, you try to avoid rules, and then you incur fines, and then you face that dreaded sight of the traffic police coming to you with a challan. And we are all familiar with the sequence of events. And talking about this issue right now is my colleagues Jyotika and Jeevan. Jyotika, do take us a little bit through this new act. It has a highly punitive kind of one tone to it, which there's a bit of a divided opinion about it. Some reports do tell us that people all over, the sheer scare of having to pay hefty fines has led to enforced good behavior on the part of motorists and people.
Yeah.
Do tell us something about this.
Okay, I'll just give you a little brief about this Motor Vehicle Act. This Motor Vehicle Act 2019 was passed earlier this year by the Parliament. And before passing through the Parliament, a State Transport Committee was formed, which had done deliberations, and after that only the bill went to the Parliament.
That's right.
So all the stakeholders, which include states, because motor vehicle is a in concurrent list, and both state and center have part to frame rules on it. So states were given an opportunity to raise their concerns, to raise their apprehensions, and to raise whatever issues they had when it comes.
Obviously, traffic is the same thing everywhere, and why should there be a kind of difference in approach between states?
The thing is, actually, when it comes to traffic and when it comes to fines, it becomes a very political sensitive issue, you know. Now, if you see, for the implementation of Motor Vehicle Act 2019, all over the states, all over India, states are absolutely divided.
That's right.
There are some states which are, you know,
they have backed out. A lot of states have backed out.
There are states which are governed by non-BJP states, basically. They are now enforcing this, saying that we are finding a difference among the people behavior, and there is a discipline.
So this is an issue where the divide is not exactly political in that sense, as we might find on many other issues, but a kind of preference towards for a kind of approach to traffic management.
Absolutely, absolutely. Before we go ahead, I just want to pinpoint two things. One, India is one of the most is one of the countries which has most number of road accidents in the world. We have around 1.5 lakh people die every year because of road accidents, and we have around 5 lakh accidents.
These are very, very high numbers actually.
So the Motor Vehicle Act 2019 basically is trying to bring this number down.
Yeah, so, but the important question here is that will it, I mean, is increasing fine the only way out?
It's
that
one
is
of the
very
ways.
Important.
It's
yeah,
one of the
and,
ways.
But should it be given priority? That is also very important, because what you have done, Motor Vehicle Act, you have a lot of other amendments. There are I think above 90 amendments are there. A lot of things, advisory board will come up, a lot of things will happen. But then you gave priority to only one fine part. So you implemented fine first and other things will happen later.
Yeah.
So I think this is something which is creating, you know, a very uncomfortable situation among people. Drivers, you know, and traffic police also. You see the clashes in last.
No, Jeevan, I would differ in opinion
please,
a little, because
please.
The lack of consensus is visible right here. And so
from the most of the traffic police people who are IPS officers I have spoken to, they are saying that's the only way to go ahead, especially in a country like India where people are. People take pride in flouting norms, and most of the traffic norms.
It's not everybody. I mean,
most of the traffic norms are broken by youngsters who are in the age group of 18 to 34.
So the idea of putting a scare in their minds actually does work.
That will create a gap. But yes, there's the other side of
the money to pay, and they need to ask from parents.
But a lot of people are here who can easily pay 5,000, 10,000, and get away with it. I mean, so
you know, the criticism is slightly more more profound than this at some level.
Yeah.
You know, we have a piece by the road safety expert Dinesh Mohan here, who makes a couple of very, very valid points. You know, to begin with, accidents can often happen not because of negligence or violation of rules by drivers, but because of the inherent flaws in road design and traffic management, many other things relating to traffic management, how the curbs are, how the the dividers are, and whether the curve is whether there's a curve on the road on actually high speed, we still follow very, very outmoded these things while we are spending a lot of money on highways, and still using kind of idea about road design that perhaps does not apply to, and spending thousands of crores on it, and perhaps generating the capacity to produce more and more accidents all over the place.
And if you see in most of the cases what these traffic police they do, most of the cases in an accident they file the case as hit and run. So in hit and run, you don't have any person to be held responsible. Suppose there's a flaw in a road design.
No authority is ever responsible.
Exactly.
The blame devolves entirely.
Contractor, designer, government officials. You don't, hold them responsible, and then only driver or the victim.
That's
the driver or the family members, they are the victims most of the time.
Traffic actually is not just is not just a city issue in that sense. Like, you know, we have highways. And it's something intimately connected to the mobility of goods and commodities and everything.
And it's
our economic life actually. So and lots of lives are lost. This is a very, very serious issue. It's not just a kind of a city specific thing about, you know, this road be having potholes or, but potholes are. We see year after year new roads being made, and within a couple of months, just after a fresh spell of rains, the roads again go on and people die.
Interestingly, if you see the Motor Vehicle Act, it says that you can hold the contractor responsible only after it will cause the design flaw or the problem on the road will result in death.
That's right. You have spoken to a couple of people who are activists.
Yeah, exactly.
Who have lost, family members.
They fought. They, in fact, one guy is from Faridabad. He went to the High Court and he convinced the court that why these contractors should be held responsible.
This is after his bike hit a pothole and his 3-year-old child died. You know, so.
So only increasing fine again. I think on the same point. Only increasing fine will create discontent. Contentment among people, they will feel that, you know, that you are only holding responsible for all these accidents to them. So I think there are other measures also. You are talking about a lot of advisory things, a lot of design stuff, a lot of other stuff. So until unless you do all that, I think this will create a gap between police and traffic police and people.
But it's vital to remember that, like, you know, best practices are actually most imperative that you follow them. Have your vehicle insured. Drive on lanes. Don't do drunken driving. And wear helmets. That's the fact whether you've worn a helmet or not makes a huge difference in the fatality rate. And wear your seatbelt. And talking of seatbelts, there were a group of people who wore a kind of seatbelt when they were riding horseback. A few decades ago, these are the dacoits of Chambal, and we have a story here from Jeevan on a very fascinating thing. There's an old temple dating from the Gujarat Pratihara dynasty, the Bateshwar temple.
It was
absolutely, like, you know, in more or less pristine shape as long as dacoity was alive.
Yeah.
And because that formed the refuge for the dacoits, and, you know, they were taking care of it.
Yeah.
And the minute, you know, the so-called reforms and dacoity was abolished and everyone surrendered, what happened is that the government now, it devolved upon the government to take care of the temple, and what we see is neglect.
Yeah, it's a neglect.
And
yeah,
it's a fantastic temple.
I think if we see, there are 400 big and small temples, and only 80 are restored till now. And more than 300 still in a very bad shape. If you go there, you see beautiful.
Look at this
statues.
One, for instance.
Yeah,
this looks like the Indian Parliament. And probably built about a thousand years ago.
Yeah, a lot of archaeologists feel that the design of Parliament has been inspired from this.
The Parliament of dacoits.
Padavali, yes. Ye Chausat Yogini Temple, we call it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
This is in Padavali village there. And this is beautiful. But again, you know, it's all in neglect. And I think we are talking about, within the country, tourism, people should visit.
That's right.
Visit places.
So now dacoits have come forward and petitioned the government that, you know, they be engaged with conservation.
Yeah, Mohar Singh, one of the dreaded dacoits that time, he had 400 cases against him, and he wrote a letter to the Prime Minister saying that please do something, because there's an issue of employment also. If these things will be taken care of, a lot of tourists will go there, so a lot of employment.
This is in a slightly impoverished part of the country.
Yeah.
It's a place called Morena, Bhind and Morena, just on the outskirts of the vast Chambal ravines. And do not be afraid of dacoits. The dacoits have all surrendered and they're all nice guys now. And these are beautiful temples. Prime Minister Modi wants you to travel inside the country.
Gabbar Singh's relative has also written.
Gabbar Singh's relative.
Yeah.
If you want to meet Gabbar Singh's relative.
Gabbar Singh,
this is the place to go. And and pose with a rock and don't carry guns. Thanks.